There's a website out there called thetop10s.com. Through voting, this site generates a top list for everything from the top 10 battles in history to the top 10 house pets. When they surveyed the globe about the top 10 biggest pet peeves, here were some of the answers. Number 1 was when people chew with their mouth open. Number 3 was about people who have bad driving etiquette. Number 7 was when someone else copies you. And number 10 was screaming children who were having temper tantrums. Here's what I found interesting. Most of the things on this list had to do with things that other people do. There was nothing on this top 10 list that said things like, when I oversleep, when I talk bad about one of my friends for no reason at all, when I get jealous because of something a friend of mine has or does. Nope, it was all about someone else. If you and I had enough time to think about it, we could all probably list our own top 10 things that tick us off. And chances are good that they would all follow the same pattern. Other people and what they do or don't do. The bottom line is that whether it's chewing, driving, or copying, we don't like it when other people do stuff that we don't want them to do. This is fun and funny to talk about when it comes to stuff that just generally annoys us. But it gets way more personal when it's real life stuff that isn't just annoying, but actually hurts us. When a friend talks bad about you behind your back, it hurts. When your mom makes a rude or hurtful comment about you, it bothers you, right? When one of your supposed friends likes and comments on every single one of your ex-boyfriend's Insta posts, it gets to you, doesn't it? If you didn't relate to those, let me throw some more examples your way. Your dad misses your soccer game. A teacher gives you a bad grade and then brings it up in class and embarrasses you. Your brother makes fun of you. Your coach yells at you. You know what it feels like to be hurt by other people. And as terrible as that feeling is, here's something you can be sure about. It's going to happen. Being hurt or frustrated by people is inevitable. We can count on it happening. And when that happens, we are left with the decision. What do we do now? How are we going to respond? Chances are all this talk about hurt and frustration brings a current situation in your mind. It's probably different than any of the examples I just brought up, but you instantly thought about it. And if that's the case, here are some things that may have happened. Your heart rate increased. You got irritated. You started thinking about all the ways you've been wronged. You felt sorry for yourself. You started rehearsing your side of the story in your mind. But here's something to notice. All of these things have one thing in common. You. They're all about how you feel, how you've been wronged, and your side of the story. And that's exactly what we all do. Young or old, freshman or senior or leader, when we get mad or sad, we focus our attention on ourselves because we want ourselves to feel better. And if you've ever spent much time stewing on something that hurt you or ticked you off, you know that feeling better is the opposite of what happens. Instead, we get more fired up than before. And when you and I get to that point, ticked off and focused on our side of the story, we are in danger of doing something that ultimately we'll regret, either now or later. And in this series, Now and Later, we've been looking at wisdom or good advice that can help us live in a way that leads us to less regret and an all-around better life. And the advice we're talking about today has the potential to forever change the way we handle conflict with the people around us. All of the wisdom and good advice we've been talking about comes from the book of Proverbs, a book mostly written by King Solomon, known as the wisest man who ever lived. He also had a huge family, which means that he probably faced a lot of moments of annoyance or hurt. Given the fact that Solomon was full of wisdom and wanted to offer advice on how to make life better, it's no surprise that he had something to say about patience because, let's be honest, patience always makes your life better. You never hear someone say they regret practicing patience. Check out what Solomon says. A person's wisdom yields patience. It is to one's glory to overlook an offense. In this verse, he's saying that a person's wisdom leads to patience. And here's the thing, most of us think of patience like waiting on an Amazon order to show up or waiting for the next season of Stranger Things to show up on Netflix. It's the thing we have to survive, like the three dots blinking on our phone as we wait on someone to text us back. But patience isn't just about waiting on something. It's also something we have to have with people, and that can be really challenging. In this case, when somebody hurts you, patience is about developing the skill of slowing yourself down before you respond to that person. This doesn't mean that you ignore your hurt feelings or allow yourself to be bullied and pushed around. It doesn't even mean that you continue to be friends with someone who continually puts you down. It just means that you know how to take a minute, take a breath, and take a step away without getting into attack mode. It's about adding a pause. Take a breath. So Solomon connects this idea of a delayed response to wisdom. Here's what wisdom looks like. When someone hurts you, rather than being immediately defensive, take a pause before you respond. And here's why this matters. We don't always know what's going on in someone else's life. In other words, when a friend talks about you behind your back, you consider how they may be acting out of insecurity. When your mom makes a rude comment, you take into account that she may be under a lot of stress right now. When your dad misses a big event in your life, you think through how he may be super busy with work. In other words, overlooking an offense means not just looking past what is happening to you right now, but also looking toward what else might be happening in a person's life. It's learning to see yourself as a part of the story, but not the whole story. Essentially, a wise person can see beyond the immediate circumstances and beyond themselves. Anytime you learn to do that, you're well on your way to finding more peace and less stress. Not only that, you'll find yourself able to stay calmer instead of falling apart. Wisdom gives you patience. Understanding a situation gives you patience. Wise people are patient people with themselves and with others. Which makes the opposite true. Unwise people are impatient people. An unwise person is someone who believes they know best. They are convinced they are the central character to their story. They think they know what should happen in any and every circumstance. They can maneuver and manipulate their way into control. They believe that they know how and when things should happen. That's why unwise people are annoyed all the time, and the word patient is never used to describe them. Because when you think you know what's best and you know what people deserve, you'll be frustrated until you either get your way or until they get what they deserve. It's a miserable way to live. More than that, it's a small way to live, because all it ever does is make you think about yourself. Unwise, impatient people are people whose world has become all about them. Solomon tells us to be wise, to seek understanding and trust that God is in charge. When you remember that, patience will develop over time, which is why the verse continues the way it does. Let's look at it again. It is to one's glory to overlook an offense. That's a pretty big statement. It's to your glory to overlook something or someone who's annoying you. It's to your glory to take into account the other person's circumstances. Most of the time when you hear the word glory, it's in the phrase glory days, like back in the glory days of SEC football or back in the glory days of 90s hip hop. It's basically referring to when something or someone was at their best. And the same is true for you. When you overlook someone's offense, two things are true. One, you look your best. Other people notice that you're being mature, taking the high road, not losing your chill. And two, you actually are at your best. It makes you a better, stronger version of yourself. It makes you wiser. But the opposite is true too. When you refuse to overlook an offense, you will be the person who hurts the most. It will damage you to hold on to an offense. It will consume your mind and dominate your emotions. Overlooking an offense sets you free from the emotional control an outside circumstance can have on you. Of course, all that sounds nice until somebody actually ticks you off. Then it can be hard to actually do the overlooking part. Here are a few things to keep in mind. It starts with understanding that everybody has a story. People generally don't do hurtful things just because. There is usually something in their life history that has led them to this moment. And when we take the focus off ourselves, we are more likely to see this. When people do things that bother you, they're probably not out to get you. Chances are, they have things going on that you and I don't know about. We have to learn to be generous with our thoughts towards people. We have to learn to believe the most generous story about them. So, learn as much as you can about someone's story, and remember this. Patient people know there's more to the story. Patient people slow down their response, learn how to look beyond themselves, and try to figure out what's going on with the person who has offended them. Because it's wise to do so, and it's to one's glory to do so. It helps everyone, both now and later. This week, I want you to think about that one person who bothers you. I want you to think about their story. What do you think they are going through? And how might that be affecting them? Then, I want you to practice shifting the story from being about you to being about them and what they might have going on. Practice patience. Practice wisdom. Imagine if you practice this enough that you actually became a patient person. that this kind of patience came naturally to you. And imagine if the people in your life did this for you. If your parents, your siblings, or your boyfriend or girlfriend chose to take a breath, slow down, and hear your side of the story, your life would be so much better now and later. It starts with knowing that there's more to the story. Hurting people hurt people. If someone takes a jab at you, it's likely because there's something uncomfortable going on in their lives. Instead of reacting out of anger and impatience, you can be the one to slow your roll and be generous with your response. Because remember, patient people know there's more to the story.